Okay, so it's 3 o'clock Central European time. Then let's get started. I am Martin. I am CEO and co-founder of smartcredit.io. And today we'll present about the topic coronavirus economical crisis versus the financial crisis of 2008. Where is the difference? Which one is worse? Which one is better? So, wait, there's some late joiners. Let me admit them. So, we are organizing these seminars every Sunday. So, practically every Sunday, 3 o'clock Central European time. And we keep doing this for sure till the summer and then later as well. So, our main focus is, of course, on the blockchain and then the crypto. But we will speak as well about the economy because these things, they very much interacting very much with each other. So good. Now about myself. Okay, like I'm co-founder and CEO of smartcredit.io. I worked 10 years as a VP for Credit Suisse in Zurich, and then when I left the Credit Suisse, then me and my twin brother, we created smartcredit.io. It's a crypto lending platform. Now before Credit Suisse, I spent a lot of time in startups, more than 10 years. Did some successful products, and I'm MBA, CFA, and I have some other degrees as well. Therefore, it's very easy for us kind of to analyze what is happening on the markets. Okay, now let's look on the agenda. We're doing 50 minutes. So we are looking what is happening at the markets now, and admit what is happening on the market and why it's happening on the market. Now, the big question. Are we getting a recession? Is recession coming? Then the question, in which phases will the crisis play out? So we see the current phase, what is the next phase? So we have to think a little bit forward. Then we look as well on the 2008 financial crisis and difference, then the 2020 recession, what is the difference? So, and then we have, then I think we will have that 15 minutes or 10 minutes for questions answers. These are then via chat. Now I muted all of you, but you can always use the chat to send the questions. You can send questions as well during the presentation. Okay, let's get started. Now this chart here, this is Standard & Poor's. It's for the last 12 years. We see the February 09, the Standard & Poor's was very much down, S&P index, and see it went pretty much up, and it's falling down. So it fall down on the. That was on the 0.618 Fibonacci support level. It bounced back, and we think it will keep falling more and more down. So, because we have to see, it has been a very long growth on the S&P equity markets, so it is as well a long way to go down. So we look in the further why it's going down. Now, these are the returns during the coronavirus pandemic. So we look now on the S&P index. Okay, S&P index, a main global index. But now let's look as well the other asset classes. So we see here as well commodities like crude oil. We see here Bitcoin. We see on Ethereum. We see other indexes, and on the end we see as well on gold. Now, all of the assets have been sinking. Now, of course, the Federal Reserve started with a very massive support program. Then the fiscal stimulus was as well activated. Now the markets are bouncing back, but we think this is a short-term effect. This bounce back is more like a dead cat, or actually dead bat, like a bat, a dead bat bounce. So it's bouncing back, and then it continues going down. We look forward in the next slides why it's happening. So now maybe as well this one question: why did the Bitcoin collapse a little bit in the price? Because Bitcoin and gold, they were considered like Bitcoin was considered as a safe haven asset, safe asset. So gold didn't went down, and the Bitcoin went down. Actually, it's not so. Gold went down as well, but it bounced back faster. Now Bitcoin went down, so probably it will take a little bit longer to come up. Now, why did Bitcoin crashed? Because the crash on the S&P was a crash of a big funds. Big hedge funds, and these hedge funds were over leveraged. They were speculating on a continuous growth of the S&P index, but this was a wrong bet. They were on the wrong side of the bet, and they had to put, they got a margin call. They had to put in any assets which they got, and they were selling anything. They were selling bitcoins, they were selling treasuries, they were selling gold, they were selling anything. And these events, they will continue to happen, because when the markets are moving down, there will be more margin calls, and every margin calls means as well that people are running into cash and they're selling any asset, including gold, Bitcoin, silver, Ethereum, which would be non-logical, but they will do it. Okay, so we see returns during coronavirus. So the markets are going down, inclusive of safe assets, safe haven assets. Now, this slide here. Okay, I want that you take like a little half a minute and you reflect what you are seeing here. These are 3-week aggregate initial jobless claims in United States. We see this graph now from beginning 1967 till now. So we see it's a 3-week aggregate of a jobless claims. So we see it's always like below 2,000 or so. Not 2,000, it's a unit in thousands, that means below 2 million. So 3-week aggregate, so that means for 3 weeks. However, this is now what we see in the last 3 weeks. In the last 3 weeks, in total, 16 million unemployment claims have been submitted to the United States. Let me put this in the perspective. US has in total 156 million employed people. So that means 10% of them have registered as unemployed within 3 weeks. Again, 10%. The unemployment in US before Corona events, it was below 5%. So let's make it easy. It was 5%. Now it's 15%. And it continues growing. It keeps growing. The question, why we are not seeing this in Europe? A very simple reason. Because in Europe, there's this higher social security system. The companies cannot lay off people so fast. In US, that's not the case. People can be laid off very fast. So that's what you're seeing. We see very high unemployment claims, actually so high as never ever has happened in the past. Not even in a Great Depression, 1929, 1933. Okay, let's move on to the next slide. Now, what has been the response? So we have two responses here now on this coronavirus crisis. The one is, of course, the governments. Okay, let's look on this slide. Let's reflect what we're seeing. This means the fiscal stimulus. That means government stimulus as a ratio to the GDP, gross domestic product. Now, let's think that most of the governments are in debt already, more than 100%. Now let's look on the UK. I think UK debt is 120% of the GDP. Within weeks, they add 20% of this debt. Japan, I think they are in debt like 200% of the GDP. They added 19%. The same for other countries less. So we see the states, the governments, which have been very much in a debt, they keep adding new debt. No, but this is just the beginning of the crisis. So let's think what happens if this crisis plays out. Okay, let's go to the next slide. Now, like I said, one of the responses is then the fiscal stimulus. But the second response that we are seeing, this is a central banking stimulus. Now, this is the Federal Reserve balance sheet. Okay, base money of the Federal Reserve. So Federal Reserve creates base money. And the commercial banks, they create credit money. So base money is 10% of total money. The credit money by commercial banks, this is 90% of the total money. Now, we're speaking of this 10%, which is created by central banks. Okay, in this case, Federal Reserve. Let's look on the very left on the screen. We see there 2008, this spike up, and this was the Lehman crisis. That was before Lehman crisis, when the Federal Reserve started to increase the balance sheet. It was this subprime crisis. We'll look on this later. Now, and after that, we see this stepwise moving up. This were all this QE1, QE2, QE3, QE4. And now we see this massive spike. So practically 4 millions to 6 point something, 4 trillions to 6 point something trillions. But this is just the beginning, because the Federal Reserve committed 2.2 trillions expansion, but Federal Reserve will issue now additional loans to the companies for $4 trillion. And like I said, we are just on the beginning of this crisis. The 2008 crisis took quite some time to play out. And we have all the commitments of Federal Reserve of $6 trillion. the $2 trillion have already been implemented, where initial balance sheet base money was of $4 trillion. So we're speaking of 150% expansion on the balance sheet on Federal Reserve. Now, the other central banks are doing something similar, but they are not so aggressive yet. So US is doing more because US dollar is a reserve currency. The others are doing the same, and they will do more in the future. Okay, let's move to the next slide. Now, let's speak to Corona. The question is, how long will this coronavirus, how long will this crisis take? So we have here like a schematic chart, and different states are here on this chart. So we see India is quite on the beginning and China is rather on the recovery phase. Now, let's think on China. How long did it took for China to get in the recovery phase? You can speak, it was 2.5 to 3 months. So we can expect at least the same in Europe. Why at least? Probably it's even more, because the Europe didn't react so aggressively as China. China had very hard, or very fast social distancing and everything related, so Europe is a little bit more relaxed. So we will speak of the economy lockdown at least 2.5 to 3 months. So that means this unemployment claims, this fiscal stimulus, this central banking new money printing, meaning base money creation, it will continue. Okay. Now let's compare the market crashes which we have had. Okay, on the left, you see like how much the markets have been declining on these bigger crashes. So let's look a little bit on the numbers. So 1929, the Great Depression, the S&P, okay, Dow Jones this time, then declined like 80%, a little bit more than 80%. So 1987, the Black Monday, and we had 30% drop. The 2000, this was this internet crisis, internet bubble, 34 drop. 2008, financial crisis, 49 drop. And now we had the 27 drop on the market. And there was a bounce back. But if you look on the previous, if you look on the previous ones, okay, it's the same as we said before. So we think it will continue. It will continue to grow. It will continue to decline the markets. Now on the right, we are seeing peak to true declines. So like how long did it took for the crisis? And what we have to say, if we are stopping economy, which has been down now, and then we are restarting it, you cannot restart economy just within a month or two. Restarting economy takes you 5 times, 10 times more longer time than stopping economy, because economy is interconnected network. So if you're seeing here that the corona crash has only 1 month, we have to estimate that the corona crisis term will be as well, 18 months, will be 24 months. And on the left side, the market decline, like we spoke before, it will be as well bigger, so probably like a 50% or if not bigger market decline. Why? Because the impacts on the real economy are very huge. So now let's continue to the next slide. I have to admit some people there on the meeting. How will this crisis play out? Okay, this is what we are saying. It will be the crisis roadmap that we are seeing. So let's analyze this crisis. What we are seeing now, we are in the phase of declining revenues. Why we have declining revenues? The companies are closed down. There's a supply shock. So the companies cannot deliver. Now, supply shock transfers to the demand shock. So if I need to deliver something, I need supplies from other companies that the companies are not delivering. And what happens? I cannot deliver my stuff. And so it goes through the full economy, through all countries, step by step. So initial supply shock, lockdowns translates into demand shock, and we are getting deflationary economy. Now, the response, it's a base money creation. Like we look, the Federal Reserve has done a massive base money creation and announced even more, just to, they're trying to create the confidence in the markets. And we see the fiscal stimulus packages, okay, like we described on the previous slide. So we see from 19%, from 20% in UK till other countries a little bit less. And the other thing, these are countries where the government debts are already very high. So that's the initial response. Now, then we are getting this second phase. Now we're speaking here of the real economy. We're not speaking of banking sector, we're speaking of real economy. So supply chains, one company deliver to the next company, and then companies deliver to consumers. Second phase will be failing zombies. Now, who are the zombies? They're not the movie, the zombies from the movies, from the scary movies. They are the zombie companies. These are the companies which can exist only because of current very low interest rate environment. So take financial crisis. The resolution for this was to reduce the interest rates, to reduce them massively, worldwide, everywhere. And with these very low interest rate environments, of course, there were quite so many companies which succeeded to survive only because of these very low interest rate environments. Now, but this low interest rate environment, okay, there's a base low interest rate environment. On top of this, we have a credit spreads. Now, the credit spreads start to widen. Why? Because the banks are saying there's more risk. And as there is more risk, they will widen the credit spreads, meaning the interest which the zombie companies need to pay starts to increase. It's the same for the state or for the government debts. The interest that they have to pay starts to increase. But let's focus on the zombies. Now, credit spreads are growing. The zombies cannot take any more new loans, because what the zombie companies are doing, they're taking new loans to refinance the old ones. They're not generating enough revenues. There's not enough cash flow to keep the loans running. And they're just refinancing. So in Europe, 15% to 20% are the zombie companies. So, okay, I think in US, it's kind of the same numbers. So significant part of economy. And these zombie companies, this is the major, this is the main result of the last economic crisis of 2008, the creation and existence of the zombie companies. Now, when zombie companies start to default on the loans, banks start to take losses. So now banks' losses, on the beginning, they are not bad. It's not nothing to be worried, because banks have as a buffers for this, they have loss provisions. But on one day, these loss provisions will be not be enough to accumulate these losses. And then banks have to start these losses directly on the balance sheets, meaning they have to compensate the losses with the equity. Now, the response on this, because the Federal Reserve will look and other ECB will look as well, oh my God, the banks are going down. And they will respond with a massive base money creation. They will buy out any assets, like they did in the past 10 years, from the banks, not only like government bonds, but as well corporate bonds, or they're going even down the ladder to the junk bonds. They will buy them out and just push banks, push money into the banks, because they want to avoid the credit crunch. The credit crunch is an event where the banks reduce the amount of credit to the economy, meaning the credit money will start to collapse. It's a credit money collapsing because banks see too high risk in the economy, and it's a fully right to see it. So every bank individually is doing the right decision, and in a total, the aggregate, we're getting then the credit crunch in the full economy. Now, the credit crunch means again that the zombies start to more default, because the interest rates are going up, the revenues are declining, they cannot finance the loans, and then we're getting this cycle, the failing some zombies. Now, the failing zombies, they create then this next is bank failures. So, syndromes, bail-ins, meaning your assets in the banks will be converted to bank equity. This is called a bail-in. And bail-in is already in the law in Europe. By the way, I was core program manager of Too Big to Fail for Credit Suisse. No, but just a remark closed. So, these are the bail-ins. Practically, you take the deposits of the clients, you convert them into equity of the bank companies, and then clients will be the owners of this equity. Now the problem is the value of this equity is zero. That's the problem. So the people will lose the money in the bail-ins. So they're calling it bail-ins. It's not a bail-ins, it's stealing money. But it's a nice name to use it, bail-ins. Now, the other are bailouts. That means the government will jump in. The government will then probably jump in on the bigger banks, which are then, let's call it, systemically very relevant for the payments and so. That's where we'll have the bailouts. So bail-ins, bailouts as a response to the bank failures. And now what we start to see in the third phase is an inflationary economy. Because in the first phase and the second phase, there's been massive money printing, a base money extension, let's see, like a Federal Reserve, 150% announced within 2 months. But the other central banks will follow. And this additional base money will start to create inflation. So in the beginning, we'll have a deflationary economy. Now, as a next, we'll get an inflationary economy. What is the response on this? Standard. It's a standard response. That central banks, it's always the same thing. Lower interest rate, good. Now, if you cannot lower the interest rate, you go negative interest rate. Okay, but this doesn't work well for the banks, so they cannot go too much negative. So that means then they start to create more base money. They're just creating more base money just to fill in the holes, any holes that they're getting. Now, they will nationalize the banks after the bail-ins and bailouts because they want to create trust again in the banking sector. And then, as well, probably where the assets is the pension funds. So we're getting a nationalization of the pension funds. And all of this will lead into the fourth phase. That's a monetary reset. Now, what are the syndromes? Because it's no trust in the existing monetary system. Because if so much new base money is created to fill in the holes in the banks, here and there, in the corporate zombie companies, this money will come into circulation, the inflation will follow. So we can, okay, when we are in the fourth phase, how do we recognize this? Very easily. The gold and BTC, they go up 100 times, if not more, in the fiat, because it's just oversupply of the fiat. Too much fiat money in the economy. The response on the fourth phase, okay, that's all forecast. It will be then the new gold-based base money, meaning new reserve currency, will be created, either national or supranational. So that means we are here on the first phase, declining revenues. Now, the governments try to stop this, but we're saying the scale of this is just so big, you cannot stop it. So we get the second phase of falling zombies. Now we have to think that the fiscal, the failing zombies means that they need more loans, these companies. But there is a credit crunch. Now the governments have to refinance their debt. Right? Then additionally, what we need is the companies need to refinance, the banks need to be refinanced. And all of this results in this, there's no money available and the credit crunch in a parallel. And who will fill in the money? These are the central banks just by creating additional money supply. Okay, this is failing zombies, the bank failures, which will then lead to the reset, monetary reset. Okay, now let's get to the 2008 financial crisis. Now we spoke here about the current crisis. Let's speak now about 2008, and then we look what are the differences in 2008 and the current crisis. Now, 2008 crisis, we see here as well. Okay, let's look on the left on the screen. Okay, that's S&P index. Then S&P, there was an internet bubble. After internet bubble, then the markets came down for 2 years or so. So let's think of the internet bubble. They came down 2 years after 2008 financial crisis. They came down 2 years. So they keep as well now coming down 2 years or longer. So there's nothing like bouncing back fast. So, and then we got this financial crisis we see what happened. So S&P index, such as an indicator, dropped from 1500 down to 668. So around in this area, 666 probably. Okay, that's just the syndrome. Now let's analyze why did this crisis happen. So, it's in the same structure as the previous one here. So, four phases, roadmap of 2008 financial crisis. First phase, subprime. Okay, I think most of people know here, there was a mortgage-backed securities and collateral debt obligations, crashes of them. So, And this happened in 2007 already. And then Fed created this massive base money supply. I remember when these announcements came out, it was August 2007. It was like Fed pushed like $100 billion new base money into the economy. And I was thinking, oh my God, these are unbelievable numbers. No, these numbers were unbelievable at that time. These are daily business now. So it was a subprime crisis. So MBS CDO crash. First phase. Now we see that, so we're speaking of financial instruments, and financial instruments has lost the value. Now, but because financial instruments were on the bank's balance sheets, banks had to take losses. And what happens? So Lehman bankruptcy, because Lehman had to take losses. So the market knew it. The counterparties were not lending any more funds to Lehman. And because Lehman couldn't refinance themselves, okay, the next step was a bankruptcy. And this sent in the shock waves. Now we're getting the banking crisis. So 2008 was just an example of a banking crisis. This sent in the shock waves to the banking, because what happened, none of the banks started to trust then the other one. Every bank started to hold the money. Of course, a credit crunch followed. There was not so much bank lending anymore. Banking crisis. However, there's a limited number of the banks in Europe. There's a limited number of the banks in US and as well in other countries. So response, typical central banking response, create more base money and push this to the banks who have troubles. How did they push this to the banks? So practically the banks had some assets. It's called whatever kind of MBSs and CDOs they had. And then the central banks just bought up, actually it's a collateral lending against collateral, lending against the MBS and CDOs, and the banks got the fresh money. And with this fresh money, they could then survive again a little bit. So typical reply, typical standard reply, standard operating procedure, create more base money and lower the interest rate now. We cannot lower the interest rate now anymore because it is zero. If it's getting negative, it will hurt the banks, so it cannot go down so much anymore. So the only response then for the central banks is create more base money. Okay, then this financial crisis 2008 went into third phase. It's a credit crunch. Now banks started to lend less money. Why? Because banks didn't trust the others. So because no one knew who is the next Lehman. So there were as well CDSs, credit default swaps in a game, but the credit default swaps means there's as well a counterparty. Now, how stable is this counterparty? And no one trusted anyone. So banks started lend less money. So that means the credit money. So we have base money, central banks are creating, and we have credit money, commercial banks are creating. Banks started to create less credit money. So the amount of credit money in the economy started to collapse. We had a credit crunch. The response, fiscal stimulus packages. Like anyone who wanted could get some money. Now, fiscal stimulus package sounds nice, but the governments have to take on debt to finance these fiscal stimulus packages. So this was the third step. And now the fourth step, this credit crunch translated into the real economic crisis. Syndromes, so revenues declined of the companies. So declining revenues meant as well that the profit margins went down. Net profit margins from declining profits triggered the decline of the stock prices that we looked before, and some companies bankrupted. So, but now what we are seeing here, and compared to the Corona crisis, is 2008 was a financial crisis. Central banks tried to contain it, then the governments jumped in, they came in with the fiscal stimulus packages. Okay, and there was some spillover on the real economy. And okay, there was some cleaning on the real economy, but not so much cleaning. But we see the scenario was this financial instruments triggered a banking crisis, triggered a credit crunch, triggered real economic crisis, but this phase two got pretty contained. So, now, if you're looking at the current crisis, we are starting from the real economic crisis. We are starting from supply shock and demand shock. We're going to deflationary cycle. So first deflationary cycle. So first two phases, they will play out in the real economy. And then they are getting into the financial, into the banking sector. And that makes the current crisis then very much different from the 2008. Because we start from the real economy, and from the real economy via zombie companies, then it transfers into the banks who start to take the losses, huge losses. Here, other way, there was a banking crisis which started to transfer to the real economy. But the second phase of this banking, of this crisis, it got relatively contained. We had a standard operating procedures, but the central banks create more base money. So, okay, now let's continue. And here is now just as a little table. Now let's compare then these two financial events, coronavirus crisis and 2008 financial crisis. Okay, let's look on the first. It's a summary. So coronavirus crisis, it's a real economic crisis which will turn into the banking crisis. Now, they try to contain the real economic crisis, but they just cannot contain because the impact is too big. And the impact is too big because we have too many zombie companies, the companies which can exist only in super low interest rate environment, not in a normal interest rate environment. What is the normal interest rate environment? Normal interest rate environment should correspond with the inflation. Now, this inflation calculation, which we are using now, this is what family Clinton introduced in 1990s. The Clintons wanted to reduce the social security payments and got a great idea. Wow, if the inflation calculation is less, smaller, then we have to pay less social security pensions. So they changed the calculation. If you're using the calculation methods which were used in a pre-Clinton family era, we're getting US inflation 6%. Now 6% should be as well at least the interest rate in the real economy. If you're going to 6% interest rate, the zombie companies will be gone and they will take down a lot of banks. And so, but that means we're speaking of zombie companies. Again, summary, real economy crisis turns into banking. But 2008, it was a banking crisis, which then started to transfer a little bit spillover into the real economy. Now, size of crisis. The current size of crisis will be bigger than 2008. 2008 was big. The current size of crisis will be bigger again, because we are starting the real economy. Let's think again on the US unemployment numbers. Let's think on the how much the assets have been declining. Let's think how long the lockdowns will continue. Let's think on China examples, or we're speaking 3 months lockdowns. Let's think on this economic damage which will be done on these 3 months, and who has to cover this damage. Now, key issue in the coronavirus crisis. So failing zombie companies will bring down the banks to fail. So we'll get the banks failure. So we are now in the phase of declining revenues. Then we have zombie companies start to fail, and then the banks start to fail. 2008 financial crisis, the key issue. Banks did not trust the counterparties anymore after some of them got down and got consolidated into others. And they started to reduce the credit into the real economy. So now response mechanism, coronavirus. Response, standard operating procedure, create more base money and give it to the banks in the hope that banks will do lending. Banks will not do lending because banks will increase the credit spreads. They will reduce the lending. The credit money will collapse. That means we'll get a credit crunch. And the second response is massive fiscal stimulus. Well, let's keep in mind governments need to finance themselves. They don't need only to finance this extra. They need to finance as well all the other 120% GDP loans. Let's take Italy. Like in Italy, half of the loans are less than 12 months. So Italy has, I think, 130% of GDP loans. And now half of them, like 65%, need to be refinanced with the next 12 months. These are short-term loans. Now everyone wants to refinance. On top of this refinancing, we'll get as well then the new loans and the credit crunch. So this means this the market will not accumulate this government demand. Who will accumulate? It's the central banks. that central banks will accumulate the government bonds. And when they are doing this, there's a new base money created, new base money printed. We're getting more and more base money, which leads to inflation. Now, response in 2008 financial crisis, okay, QE1, QE2, QE3, QE4, low interest rate, so very low interest rate environment. Let's think again, US, we should have in pre-Clinton methods, 6%. We have now, okay, we had like 1-2%. And the massive fiscal stimulus. So the question, what was wrong with the response? Let's start with 2008 financial crisis. So the biggest mistake in 2008 financial crisis that they tried to massively contain it. So the market forces did not play it out. The zombie companies, which existed already by then, they just continued. The zombie companies continued to be on through QE1, through QE2, through QE3 and QE4, they just continued. And the trouble now is that the zombie companies have got even bigger. And the zombie issue has been delegated to the next bubble. That's where we are now. We are now in this next bubble, which burst with the zombies. So let's look on the coronavirus crisis. What's wrong with the crisis? What's wrong with the response? Stimulus. Now, if you're speaking of the stimulus, I don't object stimulus, but stimulus should be then for the infrastructure, for the old countries, not for the not giving checks to the people, not giving loans to specific companies. It's infrastructure stimulus. The second, the zombie companies, which cannot exist anyhow, they have to fail. They cannot be transported yet another 10 years, yet another 10 years, and so on and so on. The market has to clean themselves for the companies which cannot exist in the real interest rate environment. So, and that's wrong with the response. So, because the more they are prolonged, the more the great damage down the road. So, outcome coronavirus, like we said before, it will be monetary reset. Okay, outcome 2008 financial crisis. So, zombie issues will be delegated then to the next bubbles. And so we see these are then the differences between these two two crises. Okay, one of them is finished, but we are dealing with the effects of the 2008 financial crisis till now, because the economy was not cleaned, the market forces were not applied, and now we are in the coronavirus crisis. We have a bigger bubble, but this bigger bubble got a much stronger shock because of the lockdowns. The economy is de facto stopped. Speaking 10, 20%, 30% decline on GDP. There are no numbers yet. Numbers will be coming. Just by looking on the unemployment numbers, these numbers will be big. So we know which responses central bank and governments are doing. We know governments will not have funds to finance the fiscal stimulus. So we know this will lead to a massive new base money creation, meaning massive money printing. We know what will come after the massive money printing. So it will come monetary reset. Okay, this is now the comparison. And then further infos. For people who would like to read, then we have some blog articles. Okay, we have a blog article as well about this presentation, which we teach us now. It's going a little bit more in the details. You can read it if you're interested. The second blog article is a coronavirus crisis, where to invest now. So, like I said, there are some areas where you should not invest, and there are some areas where you can invest, especially the monetary assets, meaning gold, silver, Bitcoin, Ethereum, and crypto assets. Now, then there's as well this analysis about coronavirus and Bitcoin price, what's next. And we have as well a Medium article that's more general, like about the blockchain-based financial system. So that's what we are doing. Practically, are we ready to switch over? Now, you can always follow us on the Twitter, and you can as well look on the website. We have our social media links there. Now I will say, let's move to the questions. So please ask them on the chat, and then I will answer as much as I can. So please, first questions. I see that there are already some questions on the chat. Let me start to screen. Let me start to read. Can you bring an example of the zombie company? Oh, very, very good question. Okay, Asse Soga asked this question. Asse is actually as well one of our advisors. Asse is the founder of the Estonian Bitcoin Foundation. Okay, a zombie company. Let me give you two examples. The typical, the airline companies. Airline companies, they have very high fixed cost. No, they are totally over leveraged, and the very small declines in the revenues, they mean that they cannot bear the cost structure. Where most of the cost structure are the interest payments to the banks. So, or the other example, I just happened to discuss with this also about, so if you look, for example, with a company like Bolt and Uber, they will get the massive problems now as well. Because they have very high fixed costs, they're highly over leveraged, they have to refinance themselves continuously, no, but their revenues are gone. So, and these are the zombie companies, which can exist only because the interest rates have been so low, but they cannot exist in a normal interest rate environment. The normal would be 6% interest rate at the moment. Okay, now, what is your educational background? Okay, let me start from beginning. I'm MBA, I'm a CFA, Chartered Financial Analyst, and I have three more master degrees. My hobbies are monetary systems, my hobbies are credit systems, so well, these are my hobbies, and we converted this hobby into the project. So that's what we're doing, Smart Credit. That's a crypto lending platform, so with the pretty unique features. So this is my background, and my twin brother co-founder is here on the line as well. My twin brother, okay, he has even some more degrees. Okay, there's like salt. Okay, we are going to details. No, we are not like salt. Okay, salt is a custodial lending platform. We are non-custodial lending platforms. So salt controls your keys, like traditional banks. We do not control the keys. So it's a decentralized lending without that we control the keys. Now I'm thinking the next question. Okay, did not create the inflation impact as expected. Will you print and inject cash will make the inflationary impact this time? Yes. Okay, 2008. Okay, the question is why did 2008 capital new money printing did not create inflation? Okay, let's start from this, that we had these two forces in our play. One is the money printing, the other was the credit crunch. The credit crunch resulted in a total credit money declining. Total credit money declining, so there is a deflation. So now what we are seeing in this crisis now, the first phase will be deflationary crisis. So it's the same as like a 2008. So 2008, first phase was a deflationary crisis. And the second phase will get into an inflationary crisis. Why? Because the amount of money which will be printed is massively, is a factor higher than it's in 2008. So the first phase is deflationary. We will never get directly into inflationary. But the second phase, when the banks start failing, that's the moment when there's even more money printing. And why even more money printing? Because governments cannot take in new debt, except that the central banks will take it over. So central banks will be the lenders of the last resort, not for the banks, but for the governments, for the corporates, for anyone else in the world. This will lead to the increase of the base money, and the increase of the base money then will translate over to this inflationary economy, which did not happen in 2008, but this is our forecast. This will happen now when we are getting the third phase of this crisis, meaning then the bank failures. Okay. What would you advise people who are real estate investors to do and what to plan for? Okay, let me start from this. If you're looking at the real estate price, then you know there's a lot of formulas. You can look on your cash flows, what your real estate generates and so. But on the end, real estate price is driven by capability to borrow. Now, if the families or investors have higher capability to borrow, then real estate prices are higher. If they have less capability to borrow, then real estate prices will be lower. So simple it is. Now, what is triggering the capability to borrow? That's your income. It's the company's revenues now going down. So that means company's income is going down. People's salaries, or worker salaries will be reduced. That means as they reduce, their income will go down. Now the second parameter, that's on the margin. Okay, it's the credit spread, but then the corporates or individuals have to pay. So this credit spreads are going up. And now if you're putting this together, that income is declining, corporate income or individual income, and this credit spreads is increasing, then capability to borrow will decrease. Now, as capability to borrow will decrease, then real estate prices will just adjust there where the capability to borrow is at this moment. And capability to borrow will sink. So that means, okay, I'm not financial advisor. You have always to speak with your financial advisors, experts. Okay, I'm CFA and MBA, but like on these situations, I'm not fan of the real estate, which is bought on credit, because we will enter deflationary cycle first, and then after deflationary, we're getting into the inflationary. And first we have to survive this deflationary cycle. So if you have your own house for living, you have no mortgage on this, you're fine with this. Now, if you have high mortgage on this, you should try fix the interest rate, not use the floating interest rate. But I would not invest into real estate funds, or if you have investments, I would rather think about taking this money out and putting this somewhere else. Okay, do we have next questions? We have room for one more question. Okay, next question. How will the zombie-free sustainable monetary system look like? Okay, now the key to the monetary system is this, because what we have in the monetary system, this is nothing else as a centrally planned economy. This is a central, it's a Soviet central economy. Everyone knows it. Now in the Western parts of the world, we think, oh, we are better than Soviets, but we are as well in a centrally planned economy. Interest rate is planned centrally by central bankers, is implemented centrally. Now these central bankers, they think they are the best to know how much the interest rate should be. Now let's think a little bit back. Let's think back in 1850, 1870 till 1910 in the United States. That was the time where the middle class was created. Why? It was a deflationary economy. It was a free banking area, free banking era. That means we cannot have a mechanism where central banks are dictating to all economy, to everyone, like in a Soviet economy, like how much the interest rate has to be. Interest rate has to be set on the market. The second, what we have, the interest rate has to be set on the market. The second, we need multiple monies to compete with each other. At the moment, we have just central banking currencies and they can manipulate them as much as they want. I worked 10 years for Credit Suisse in Zurich. Now, during this time where I worked in a Credit Suisse, the central bank Switzerland increased the base money 10 times. 10 times, actually 11 times in these 10 years. But you cannot read it somewhere. There was one blog where you could read it. It was inside Paradeplatz. Okay, it's a German verb, German term. But you couldn't read about this anywhere. But central banks, like we described as well here, they're increasing, they're manipulating the money supply. So we need multiple monetary elements. We need like a monetary competition. We need like a Bitcoin, Ether, gold-based base money, and then on top of this, credit monies. And people can choose themselves which money do they want to use. Of course, no central bankers will come and tell you like, oh, people are not smart. Let us to decide for the people. I say, no, people are very smart. People are very intelligent. And the history shows 1870 to 1910, it was the time where the middle class was created in the United States. It was a free banking area. It was not a central banking area. So it's practically how will the zombie-free sustainable monetary system look like? So the first is we cannot have a central centrally setting interest rate. And second, we need this monetary competition between the different monies. And it's actually very simple. So even now, so people who like, because we like crypto, we think crypto is alternative to the existing central bank. People who like a central banking money, please feel free to use it, but just listen to this webinar. And people who think that maybe it's a little bit fishy, this central banking money and the commercial banking money, credit money, feel free to use Bitcoin, feel free to use Ether, feel free to use the monetary, the monies which are not manipulatable. So, okay. Good. Then this was now the last question for today. We continue on, because we keep it short, like a 50 minutes. So we continue next week again, next Sunday, on the same topic. We speak about the coronavirus a little bit, but next week topic is then on this. We speak about the interest rate a little bit. So if you look on the central banking interest rate, it looks very low, but why it's so high then for the individuals and small medium enterprises? So where is this gap? Why is this happening? Practically, why is the central banking this transmission, but always speaking that it works very nice, but it actually doesn't work? Why is this not working? So we'll speak about this topic. That's on the next Sunday, and then we continue on the crypto lending topics, on Bitcoin topics, and on the related topics. So, okay, so we recorded this video as well. It will take us now some days. We'll cut it a little bit and we'll put it as well YouTube. We will then post it on our channels. So please have a look and please join in again. Thank you.